You're listening to an Airwave Media Podcast.
Ben Franklin's World is a production of Colonial Williamsburg Innovation Studios. Hello, and welcome to episode 356 of Ben Franklin's World, the podcast dedicated to helping you learn more about how the people and events of our early American past have shaped the present-day world we live in. And I'm your host, Liz Covart. In 1682, the First Assembly of Pennsylvania and the Delaware counties met in Chester, Pennsylvania, and adopted the Great Law. The Great Law was a humanitarian code that guaranteed the people of Pennsylvania liberty of conscience. The Great Law created an environment that not only welcomed William Penn's fellow Quakers to the colony, but also created a space for the migration and establishment of unestablished religions. Religions such as the Lutherans, Schwenkfelders, and Moravians. Now, Pennsylvania's great religious diversity has inspired you to write me many emails to suggest that we cover some of the religious groups and dissenters who established new lives and communities in Pennsylvania. So this, my friend, is an episode for you. Paul Peucker, the director of the Moravian Archives in Bethlehem, Pennsylvania, joins us to explore the history and settlement of the Moravians in North America. Now, Paul is quite the historian of the Moravian Church. He's published numerous essays, articles, and books, including the edited collection, Self-Community World, Moravian Education in a Transatlantic World, and most recently, Herrnhut, The Formation of a Moravian Community, 1722 to 1732. Now, during our investigation, Paul reveals the origins of the Moravian Church in Europe and the creation of the first Moravian community in Herrnhut, Germany. Information about the Moravians' belief in Philadelphianism and why they adopted an international outlook, and details about the Moravians' migration and settlement in North America during the 1740s. But first, don't forget that April is Adopt-A-Listener Month. It's a month when we try to get more friends and family to listen to a podcast. So if you know someone who loves history but hasn't yet tried Ben Franklin's World or any podcasts, April is a great month to try and convince that person to try a podcast. So thank you for adopting a listener this month, and thank you for all the work you do to help spread the word about Ben Franklin's World. You are always helping our audience expand and grow, and the team and I are very grateful and thankful for your work. Thank you very much. Okay, are you ready to explore the early American history of the Moravians? Allow me to introduce you to our guest historian. Our guest is an archivist and the director of the Moravian Archives in Bethlehem, Pennsylvania. He grew up in the Netherlands, and he worked as an archivist in Germany before his relocation to the United States. He's written numerous articles, essays, and books, including an edited collection titled Self-Community World, Moravian Education in a Transatlantic World, and most recently, Herrnhut, The Formation of a Moravian Community, 1722 to 1732. Welcome to Ben Franklin's World, Paul Peucker.
Thanks, Liz. I'm honored to be here.
And we're excited to have you, Paul, because we're curious about the Moravians who settled in North America during the British colonial period, and we're curious about their faith and history. So I wonder if we could start our conversation with having you give us a bit of a history lesson about the Moravian Church and who the Moravians were by the 18th century.
Liz, I'm not surprised listeners have asked for an episode about the Moravians. The Moravians are definitely one of the most interesting religious groups of the 18th century. They have left a large amount of written records, which makes it possible for us to get a good understanding of their activity. But not only that, through the lens of Moravian records, we are also able to learn about religion during the early modern period in general. The Moravians started in the 1720s and quickly spread in Europe and throughout the Atlantic world. They built their own towns, such as Herrnhut, Germany, Bethlehem, Pennsylvania, or what is now called Winston-Salem, North Carolina. They were a Protestant reform movement, like the Methodists, with whom they were initially closely connected. But while 18th century Methodism was predominantly an Anglo-American movement, Moravianism was much more international. It attracted Germans, Scandinavians, English, Dutch, enslaved people in the Caribbean, American Indians, as well as the odd Italian, Persian, and Frenchmen. They were strong on education, had an impressive musical culture, incorporated paintings into their spaces of worship, studied languages, and had interesting ideas on gender and sexuality. Their views on their own history are also quite interesting. When the first Moravian community of Herrnhut was founded in the 1720s, they came to believe they were the continuation of a much older, extinct church, the Unity of Brethren. The Unity of Brethren, or Unitas Fratrum, was founded by followers of Jan Hus in 1457 in what today is called the Czech Republic. The Unity was much older than the main Protestant churches of Europe. The Unity of Brethren renounced violence, bearing of arms, and swearing of oaths, and called on believers to follow the law of Christ. In accordance with Hussite thought, the Unity of Brethren modeled itself on the Apostolic Church of the Bible. The Unity spread throughout the Czech lands, but in 1620, with the defeat of the Protestant nobles of Bohemia in the Battle of White Mountain, they were outlawed, together with the Lutherans and the Calvinists. So, although many Protestants emigrated or converted to Roman Catholicism, some went underground. And over time, we saw several waves of emigration. A century after the Battle of White Mountain, groups of crypto-Protestants in Moravia decided to leave and go to Herrnhut. The settlers of Herrnhut came to believe that God had renewed the church of their ancestors. It would be a mistake to assume that the term Moravian refers to an ethnic group. 18th century Moravians were, in fact, a diverse group of people. And when you look at the communities in the Americas, you will also find enslaved people who had joined the church, together with Native Americans or Inuit. The leader of the Moravians was Count Ludwig von Zinzendorf, on whose estate the first community of Herrnhut was founded in 1722. Zinzendorf was a nobleman who was employed at the court of August the Strong of Saxony, but as soon as he was able to take an indefinite leave of absence, Zinzendorf moved to the community of Herrnhut and became the leader of the Moravian Church until his death in 1760. Interestingly, although social differences existed among the Moravians, their goal was to create a community of equality, where someone's secular status was more or less irrelevant, and everybody was considered to be a brother or a sister. Women in Moravian communities of the 18th century played an important role, and some of them were even ordained and preached, something we do not often see with other religious groups of the time. Moravian faith focused on Jesus Christ and especially on his death. They believed that every human was saved through the death of Jesus, and in their devotions, Moravians meditated on the life, suffering, and death of Christ. We might wonder what set Moravians apart from Christian groups. Moravians themselves were more interested in what united them with other religious groups. They did not care for the theological differences between the denominations of early modern Europe, but they wanted to bring the different groups closer together. A century after the founding of Herrnhut, there were 50,000 Moravians worldwide, and today there are more than a million, and the majority of Moravians today lives in Tanzania and Africa. In the United States, there are about 55,000 Moravians today.
From your description, it seems like Moravianism was very popular with a lot of different people in the early modern era. And I wonder if we can attribute that popularity to any one aspect of the Moravian faith and community during the 18th century.
Moravian faith was very personal, and it concentrated on the individual. For a lot of people, the devotion of Christ's death was very attractive. Moravians expressed that in what is a blood and wounds theology. They meditated on the blood and wounds of Christ. And apparently that was not only attractive to certain Europeans, but also to Native Americans.
Now, Kristen would like to know when the first Moravians made their way from Germany in Europe to North America, and where they established their first settlement. Would you tell us what prompted the Moravians to consider a transatlantic migration and then to make their move to North America?
The first Moravians came to America in 1735. In total, about 40 Moravians settled in Savannah, Georgia, men, women, and children. And this was one of the first attempts by the Moravians to settle in other parts of the world. The reason for their settlement in Georgia lay in the success of the original community of Herrnhut in the eastern part of Saxony in Germany. Within 5 years, there were 200 people living in Herrnhut, and after 10 years, Herrnhut had 500 inhabitants. Although Zinzendorf was the local lord of the manor, and although there was definitely enough room for more houses, the reception of more settlers from Moravia had become a problem in the 1730s. By 1732, the settlement of Protestants from Moravia in Herrnhut had become an international diplomatic problem between the Habsburg Emperor and the Elector of Saxony. The Emperor had filed an official complaint about the reception of his subjects in Saxony, and in the fall of 1732, the end of Herrnhut seemed imminent. August the Strong of Saxony wanted Zinzendorf to sell his possessions and leave the country. There were even rumors that the king planned to imprison Zinzendorf. And without the count, the religious community on his estate would undoubtedly disintegrate. It did not come to this. Members of the Privy Council of Saxony intervened, the king died, and political reason prevailed. The Moravian settlers were allowed to stay for the time being. However, another religious group living on Zinzendorf's estate, the Schwenkfelders, they had to leave. They moved to Pennsylvania in 1734, and they continue to exist here in Pennsylvania until this day. And although the Moravian settlers were allowed to remain, it became much harder to accept new settlers, and that is why Zinzendorf and the Moravians began to look for other places to settle. One place was found in northern Germany called Pilgerruh, and one in the Netherlands, here in Dijk. They also looked at destinations overseas. They were interested in Suriname, a Dutch colony in South America, and in Georgia. So in 1735, the first group of Moravians arrived in North America, and the following year, another 25 people arrived.
Would you tell us a little bit more about the Moravian settlement in Georgia? I think when most of us think of Moravians, we're thinking about Pennsylvania and the Moravian settlement in Bethlehem. So what prompted the Moravians to settle in Georgia? And then why did they either decide to leave Georgia or expand their Georgian settlement into Pennsylvania?
In total, 40 Moravians came to Georgia between 1735 and 1740. And we know their names and we know their origins. More than half of them, 28, came from the Czech lands of Moravia and Bohemia. The others came from different parts of Germany. There were 5 married couples, the others were single, or were married people traveling without their spouses. One was a nobleman. When one of the groups was traveling from England to Georgia, John Wesley, the later founder of the Methodist Church, traveled on the ship with them. He was impressed with their behavior, and for several years he kept a close connection with the Moravians. The reason they chose Georgia as their destination was that the trustees of Georgia, the corporate body in London that was in charge of overseeing the colony, was actively seeking colonists. In 1733, the House of Commons had appropriated £10,000 to the trustees of Georgia to settle foreign Protestants in the colony. The Salzburgers were another Protestant group from the Habsburg Empire that settled in Georgia in these years. Besides colonization, the Moravians hoped to reach out to the Creek and Cherokee in Georgia. And they also established a mission among enslaved Africans in Purisburg, South Carolina. The Moravian community in Savannah, however, did not last very long. Soon, discontent among the Moravians began to grow, and individuals moved away. For a long time, historians have believed that the pressure to bear arms during the military conflict with Spain was the reason Moravians left Georgia. But historian Aaron Fogelman has shown that the real reason for the end of the Moravian community in Savannah was discontent among the Moravians themselves. In Savannah, the Moravians practiced a common household. They shared their income and provided each other with what was needed. This was the first time that Moravians practiced such a system. In Herrnhut, their first community in Germany, they did not have a common household. In Savannah, the Moravian common household caused problems, dissatisfaction, and resentment among the Moravians. In 1737, the first people began to leave the community and to move away. Most of them went to Pennsylvania.
What was the attraction of Pennsylvania for the Moravians? Was it because this was William Penn's land and Penn had founded the colony on the belief of religious freedom and toleration? Or was there something else about Pennsylvania that particularly attracted the Moravians?
Another person the Moravians got to know in Georgia was George Whitefield, an English evangelist who was popular in the American colonies. In 1740, Whitefield purchased 5,000 acres in the Lehigh Valley in Pennsylvania that he named Nazareth, and he wanted to establish an orphanage for African children here. He asked the Moravians to help him with this project, to select a location for the orphanage, and to build the facility for him. So a group of Moravians from Georgia, under the leadership of Peter Baylor, went to Whitefield's land and began the construction of the orphanage. Meanwhile, however, Whitefield had a fallout with the remaining Moravians in Georgia over the doctrine of predestination. Predestination is the belief that God, in his eternal wisdom, had already determined all events, including the question if someone will be saved or not. Moravians believed that every human being was saved through Christ's death on the cross, and it was up to each individual to accept and believe that or not. The argument got so heated that Whitefield decided he did not want to work with the Moravians anymore, and he ordered them off his land in Pennsylvania. In April of 1741, the Moravians purchased their own land, a little south of Nazareth on the River Lehigh, and this is what was to become Bethlehem. Bethlehem remains until this day the center of Moravian activity in North America. In Bethlehem, Moravians hoped to realize the ideals they had brought with them from Europe. In order to understand these ideals, we need to go back to the first Moravian community of Herrnhut. In my book on early Herrnhut, I argue that Herrnhut was supposed to be a Philadelphian community. The Philadelphian movement was a movement that originated in England in the late 17th century. Philadelphians believed none of the established denominations, so the Anglicans, the Reformed, Lutherans, or the Catholics, none of the established denominations were the true church, but that true Christians were to be found inside and outside the churches, regardless of their denominational affiliation. The Philadelphians did not think the doctrines of the churches were that important. They called them opinions, and believed they were later human interpretations of the biblical message. Philadelphians, like most other reform movements, wanted to go back to the original message of the Bible. At a time when Christendom in Europe was divided between various denominations who argued among each other about the right interpretation of Christian doctrine, Philadelphian ideas can be seen as progressive. Today, we would perhaps use the term ecumenical. At the same time, Philadelphian ideas were considered to be radical because they questioned the position of the established churches. Philadelphian ideas were popular among radical pietists in Germany. Zinzendorf was very much influenced by Philadelphianism, and the community he founded in Herrnhut was to be a Philadelphian community, not Lutheran, not part of the established church, but a movement consisting of people from different traditions that transcended the institutional churches. And these ideas were also important for the founding of Bethlehem in 1741. Pennsylvania seemed to offer the ideal conditions to establish a community of Christians from different denominations who would live together as brothers and sisters. In Pennsylvania, the traditional churches from Europe were not well organized yet, and there was also a wide range of radical believers who did not belong to any of these churches. Bethlehem was supposed to be a grand Philadelphian experiment where people would live together just like the first Christians as described in the New Testament. They abandoned traditional family structures, but considered themselves one large family of brothers and sisters. People did not live together with their physical families, but there were separate houses for the single man, for the single women, for the married man, for the married women, and for the widows and the widowers. The children did not live with their parents, but they lived in the Kinderanstalt, the children's home. Bethlehem was also a commune. Nobody received any wages, but everyone worked for the common good. The church provided food, shelter, and clothing. So after the land on the Lehigh River was bought in 1741, Moravian leader Zinzendorf came over from Germany to Pennsylvania to organize the community in Bethlehem and to see how his ideals could be realized in what for them was a new world. They were especially interested in the native population of the American colonies. Moravians established communities where they lived with the Native Americans. Some Christian Native Americans lived in Bethlehem. By the time Bethlehem was established in 1741-42, the community in Georgia had been disbanded. And many of the Georgia settlers had joined the community in Bethlehem, but some of them remained critical and did not want to be part of a communal household again.
How did the Moravians' neighbors, those who lived in Pennsylvania around the Bethlehem community, react to the communal lifestyle of the Moravians? Because many of their Pennsylvania neighbors would have come from more British and American origins, where there was this tradition or this idea that the way you succeed in life is you go out, you get a farm, you clear land, you settle it, and it's really all about self-perseverance and individualism that helps you advance and get along in the world. So how did these neighbors react to their more communal neighbors where everybody's working for the benefit of the community and living in this non-traditional life where families are separated into different houses? We're talking about neighbors who have very different cultural backgrounds and ways of life getting on together.
It was definitely different what was happening in Bethlehem. These were not individual settlers on a farm that they cleared themselves and with their family. This was a much larger group of people that worked together and was also able to draw on resources beyond their community. So in Bethlehem, one problem was the supply of water. The water, the spring was down at the creek, but the houses were up on the hill. So carrying water from down the creek up to the hill was a problem. So they got someone who knew about waterworks and got a Moravian from Denmark to set up a waterworks here in Bethlehem where water was pumped up into a water tower and then distributed into the main buildings of the community. This is just an example of how a community where people work together could accomplish things that individual settlers might have a much harder time with accomplishing. Some of the neighbors did not understand this, but some of the Moravians themselves, later generations, did not understand this communal organization either. When we look in the 19th century, Moravian historians try to prove that these Moravians, yeah, they might be living in a communal household, but that was just for practical reasons, because they needed to survive in the wilderness. They didn't want these Moravians to appear non-American because they were so much interested in a communal system and they worked together. So historians have tried to disprove that there was any deeper theological understanding to the communal organization, where in fact it was one of their ideals to live together in community.
Would you tell us more about how this communal Moravian community operated and how it was structured in terms of its governance? Was there a community leader? Did residents make decisions democratically? And how did the Moravian idea of gender equality impact how this communal community operated?
Main feature of the organization of a Moravian community, and especially of Bethlehem, is the organization in choirs. And these are not musical choirs. It comes from the same Greek root word, and it means that these are groups within the community. And the choirs were separated according to gender and marital status. So there was the choir of the single sisters, the choir of the single men, the married people's choir, the widows, the widowers. And all these choirs had their own leaders that were called by the overall church in Europe and sent here. And some of these choirs had their own buildings where they lived together, the choir houses. The overall leadership of the church was a board of elders, the elders conference, and that consisted of the leaders of these various choirs, the minister, and also the person who oversaw all the financial matters of the community. We cannot say that there was a democratic structure. Moravians would have used the word theocratic. They decided that every important decision had to be put to the lot. And through the lot, they hoped to consult Christ. So after discussion of a matter, several options were presented to the lot, and then the lot was drawn, and the lot could say yea or nay, or it could be a blank lot. And by doing that, they believed that Christ was actively participating and making the ultimate decision.
Now, if we think about it, the Moravians weren't in North America very long, just about 30 years before the outbreak of the American Revolution. What did the Moravians think about the American Revolution and its war for independence? We'll take a moment to thank our episode sponsor, and then we'll explore answers to that very question. Do you enjoy art? If so, you should be aware that the art museums of Colonial Williamsburg will be opening a brand new exhibition called Eddie Arning Artist. Eddie Arning created bold and colorful pieces using wax crayons and oil pastels to feature birds, animals, and scenes from everyday life. Eddie drew many images from his memory, and he also drew inspiration from illustrations in popular magazines. Arning was born in Texas in 1898. Due to mental illness, he spent 30 years of his life in the Austin State Hospital. It was only after his discharge to a nursing home that Arning began to draw and paint. He was most active with his artwork between 1964 and 1973. The Art Museums of Colonial Williamsburg's Eddie Arning Artist exhibition will open on May 6, 2023. To learn more about this exhibition and how you can come to view it, visit benfranklinsworld.com/Eddie. That's benfranklinsworld.com/Eddie, spelled E-D-D-I-E. Paul, how did Moravians view and think about the American Revolution? Did they ever take a side during the war?
By the time of the American Revolution, Moravians themselves had undergone some changes. After the death of their leader, Zinzendorf, in 1760, they decided to abandon many of their radical features and to reinvent themselves as a worldwide church that may have some unique features and customs, but that did not differ in theology from the main Protestant churches. They abandoned some of Zinzendorf's radical teachings, they stopped ordaining women, and reduced women's leadership roles. They revised their hymn books and their liturgies, and they ended the communal household in Bethlehem. The communal household in Bethlehem had become very popular. By 1760, it included more than 1,000 people living in different places in the Lehigh Valley, with Bethlehem as the center. Kate Carte has written a fabulous book about this topic. After 1762, families had to live together for the first time. Some of the communities within the congregation continued to exist. The single men continued to live together in the brethren's house, and so did the single women and the widows. And these buildings remain an important architectural feature of Bethlehem and of other Moravian communities such as Nazareth and Lititz in Pennsylvania and Winston-Salem in North Carolina. What the Moravians had not abandoned by the 1770s was their pacifism. Moravians refused to swear an oath, which was required in the military, and they wanted to stay out of any political conflict. The Moravian Church was a worldwide church, and church leaders feared that if they would choose sides in one political conflict, it could affect their standing in another part of the world. If Moravians, for example, would side with the American Revolution, they feared for their congregations in Britain and for their mission work in the British colonies. So Moravian men were not allowed to join militias, and the church would pay the fine that Pennsylvania imposed. The church also refused to sign the Test Act, which affected their ability to travel and put their property at risk of confiscation. American troops used Moravian buildings as hospitals on several occasions. In 1777, after the Battle of Brandywine, the Continental Army, together with many members of Congress, retreated to Bethlehem. Moravian leaders were not happy with this. In the Bethlehem Diary, they describe it as, quote, a battle between angels of light with the forces of darkness. The angels of light, of course, were the Moravians, while they considered the American troops the forces of darkness.
We know in the case of the Quakers, specifically the Quakers in Pennsylvania, that many of them were persecuted because they tried to remain neutral during the American Revolution and its war for independence. We know they were imprisoned, that they emerged as a group of disaffected because they didn't want to support any side of this conflict. And I wonder if the Moravians were treated similarly. Paul, were Moravian men arrested because they refused to choose one side or the other or support the military conflict in any way? Did their neutrality prompt any army to impress Moravian goods with more vigor than they would have impressed them in other communities? I guess what I'm really asking is, what were the repercussions of trying to remain neutral for the Moravians in the American War for Independence?
The position of neutrality, of course, made the Moravians unpopular with many of their neighbors, but also among younger generations of Moravians, there was criticism of this position. I don't think you can say Moravians tried to remain neutral because they were against the revolution per se. They supported whatever government had placed above them, so they did not resist the outcome of the revolution. Many Moravians embraced the new republic. It was a Moravian printer in Philadelphia, Henry Miller, who printed the German translation of the Declaration of Independence on July 9, 1776. But we begin to see that younger generations did not want to follow all of the rules of the church any longer. Some of the young men had wanted to join militias. During the War of 1812, many Moravians could not be stopped anymore. At the beginning of the 19th century, young Moravians also began to disobey church rules when it came to marriage. According to the rules of the church, when a couple wanted to get married, the elders had to draw the lot. By drawing the lot, Moravians believed they were consulting Christ. So in 1818, the use of the lot for marriages became optional. Before then, any couple that refused to submit their marriage to the lot or who had wanted to get married against the decision of the lot had to leave the church communities. And that changed in 1818.
Paul, we can tell by talking with you that you know a lot about the Moravians, and as you primarily work as the director of the Moravian Church Archives, I wonder if you would tell us about the Moravian Church Archives. What does your work as an archivist entail, and what types of records have the Moravians saved that tell us so much about their history?
The Moravian Archives is housed on the campus of Moravian University in Bethlehem. We are not part of the university, but the close proximity is beneficial for both institutions. We are the official repository of the records of the Moravian Church in America. There's also a Moravian Archives in Winston-Salem in North Carolina, and they are responsible for the records of the Moravian Church in the South. I have worked here since 2004, and before that, I was archivist at the Moravian Archives in Herrnhut, Germany. Originally from the Netherlands, where I got an archival degree after I finished my PhD in history.
So, fun fact, the Moravians have some of the earliest and most detailed archival records of any religious group in early America. Paul, can you tell us why Moravians kept a lot of very detailed records about their work and why they were so meticulous with their record keeping?
The Moravian archives are indeed very detailed and quite large for such a small religious group. We have records from all the Moravian communities in North America, including city congregations such as New York or Philadelphia, going back to the 1740s. We have detailed records regarding Moravian activity among Native Americans, records related to Moravian schools, businesses, and the central administration. There is a large collection of early American music, and we have a library that is one of the largest collections of literature on the Moravians in the world. We also hold records for the Moravians in Labrador, in the West Indies, and in Nicaragua. The reasons for Moravian record keeping are connected to the beginnings of the Moravians in Herrnhut, Germany. Moravian leader Zinzendorf was a nobleman who knew that in order to successfully manage an estate, you needed to keep good records. He employed a secretary who would copy outgoing letters and file away incoming letters. Because Zinzendorf traveled much, many of the developments were communicated to him in writing, and these letters and reports were then preserved. The Moravians in Herrnhut believed that their community was an extraordinary manifestation of God's activity with mankind. They believed their history needed to be written down. So starting in April of 1727, the events of each day were recorded in the Herrnhut diary. Later, whenever a new Moravian community was begun, a diary was started. Sometimes these diaries continue well into the 20th century. So Moravians believe their history a continuation of biblical history. And like biblical history, all that needed to be recorded so it could be remembered by later generations and inspire them. The first reference to the archives in Bethlehem dates from 1745. One room in the Gemeinhaus, the central building of the community, was reserved to store the records. This was at a time when living space was extremely limited in Bethlehem. Still, one room was reserved for the archives. The first time the archives were organized was in 1757, and we still have the first inventory, or finding aid, as archivists would call that. Since then, there has always been someone responsible for the archives. For Moravians, the archives contained the narratives of how God had guided them and how they were able to respond to God's call. This history was to inspire later generations and to witness of God's work through the ages.
Paul, in the grand picture of early modern religions, how common or uncommon was it for the Moravians to keep such detailed records of their religion and the works of their church?
Other groups were also keeping records, but perhaps not as detailed as the Moravians. The Moravians were organized in an international way, and a lot of it had to be reported back to Europe. So that required things to be written down. Also, important questions were posed to the central administration in Europe. So that also had to happen in writing. And Moravians were very particular about preserving this. Some of the other radical groups of the 18th century were disbanded after a while and records were simply lost. But I think there was something special about Moravian writing. Moravians were writing a lot, and that was definitely a feature of life in Moravian communities. There was even a group of people who were charged with making copies of all kinds of reports that came in and had to be sent out, and writing was an important part of Moravian life.
Although the Moravians kept really detailed records from the beginning of their church into the present day, there was a period between 1760 and 1810 where the church worked to destroy its records. Paul, would you tell us about this period of destruction and why Moravians wanted to destroy their records?
So when you consider how important the archives was for Moravians, the question what gets included in the archives also becomes important. After the death of Moravian leader Zinzendorf in 1760, the church decided to collect historical material in one place. This is what is now the Moravian Archives, or Unity Archives, in Herrnhut, Germany. By placing something in the archives, it becomes part of the history that Moravians wanted to communicate with later generations. But what do you do with those things that they consider questionable? Do you put those in the archives as well? Around 1750, there had been a crisis in the Moravian Church that caused embarrassment with many. Moravians considered this a time when the devil tried to test or sift the Moravians. They were using language from the Gospel of Luke. This sifting time was the topic of my previous book, in which I tried to unravel what the sifting time was actually about. So when this crisis was over, Moravian leaders asked many people to destroy hymn books, letters, and diaries that contained the things Moravians had become embarrassed with. After Zinzendorf's death, Moravians ended the leadership of Moravian women. So they decided to destroy the extensive correspondence of women leaders, as to not give later generations the idea that female leadership was a good thing. When I was working on my book on Herrnhut, I discovered that church leaders had destroyed the correspondence between Zinzendorf and Pastor Rothe, the local Lutheran minister. This correspondence would have shed important light on how Zinzendorf's radical position differed from the position of the Lutheran pastor, something that the leaders of the church during the 1790s did not want the outside world or later generations to know about. So they decided to destroy this correspondence.
One of the archival collections that the Moravian Church decided to keep and save were the journals and letters of Moravian missionaries. Paul, Marie is very curious about Moravian missionaries and their work. So would you tell us about their work in early America and about the Moravians who were allowed to become and work as missionaries?
Moravians were very interested in missionary work from the earliest years in Herrnhut. There was great interest to engage in work in other parts of the world. In my book on early Herrnhut, I argue that this global outlook was connected with their Philadelphian ideals. Philadelphians believed that the existing institutional churches, because of their internal disagreements, did not have a credible message and were unfit to do missionary work among non-Christians. The only people who had a credible message to the world, according to the Philadelphians, were the Philadelphians themselves, because they brought a message of unity. And that explains why Moravians immediately engaged in work in different parts of the world. 10 years after the founding of Herrnhut, the first Moravians went to St. Thomas in the Caribbean. And during the next 10 years, they went to Greenland, Suriname, South Africa, other Caribbean islands, and to North America. In America, they engaged with Native Americans in Georgia, New York, Connecticut, and Pennsylvania. And they also had a mission work among enslaved Africans in South Carolina and in Pennsylvania and New York. A Moravian missionary was usually a lay person, not someone who had studied at a university. Only thing Moravians thought important was if the missionary was truly convinced of his calling. And missionaries were not only men. They went out with their wives, and some women continued to work as missionaries after their husbands died. The women were responsible for working with the women, as Moravians believed in a strict separation of the genders, especially when it came to matters of pastoral care. Moravians did not believe in mass conversions. They wanted someone to be truly converted before they considered to baptize the person. When a missionary reported about large numbers of converts, the leadership in Bethlehem or in Europe would get suspicious and question if the missionaries were perhaps too hasty. The work among the enslaved put the Moravians in a difficult situation. In order to not upset the planters and endanger their work, they did not speak out against the institution of slavery, and that made them complicit, especially because in some places the church owned slaves themselves. The records from the various missions contain much detail about the interaction with people from other cultures. Of course, they are written through the lenses of Europeans who had a strong bias against non-Christian beliefs. But on the other hand, they are often the only written sources that exist for those particular areas. Moravian missionaries usually wrote their reports in German, and had they been written in English, I think our reading room would be full of people all the time to use this material.
So what I'm hearing is, Paul, is that for those of us who speak and read German, it seems like we can go to the Moravian Archives and conduct our own historical research. Is that true? Is the Moravian Church Archive open for anyone to use?
Yes, we are committed to provide public access, and we're open 5 days a week. A total of 42 hours is our reading room open, and everybody is welcome to use our material and to study that material here.
And for those of us who don't speak German, do you have any suggestions for how we can also access these amazing records in the Moravian Archives?
We have translators that can help, but not all the records are written in German. We also have English records. There were also English-speaking Moravians in the 18th century, although here in America, they might have been a minority. But also at the time, some of the records were translated from German into English. And a lot of our books are in English and can be used by anyone.
Before we move into the time warp, Shari would like to know, what is the one big thing you'd like us to walk away knowing about early American Moravians? So, Paul, would you tell us what you'd like us to walk away from this conversation knowing about Moravians, and maybe even why you think knowing about the history of Moravians in early America is important?
I think the Moravians are an interesting group by themselves. There are so many aspects of Moravian life that one can study, be it music or architecture or their ideas on gender and sexuality. But I think the importance of the Moravians goes beyond the Moravians themselves. Because of their good record keeping, Moravians allow us some insight in early religion. And what applies to Moravians might also apply to other people of the time. And we would misinterpret the Moravians if we would just consider them to be an ethnic group. These were people from all over Europe and all over the world that worked together, lived together, and practiced their faith together within this movement. So the Moravians tell us a lot about religion in the early modern period.
Now we should move into the time warp. This is a fun segment of the show where we ask you a hypothetical history question about what might have happened if something had occurred differently or if someone had acted differently. In your opinion, Paul, how might our understanding of early American Moravians be different had they not been so stringent about keeping a curated archive of their church?
The destruction of records is indeed a painful episode in the history of Moravian archives, especially because we know exactly what they destroyed. Good record keepers as they were, they compiled lists of categories or items that were to be destroyed. So we know what was once there and what we no longer have. But we should not think that the destruction of records or the non-inclusion of material in the archives is an unusual thing. Of all the records a modern administration produces, only a small percentage will eventually make it into the archives. Archivists have rules and procedures in place to make that decision. There are also other factors that restrict access to historical material. How do archivists describe and categorize the records? Are the finding aids accessible to the user? And what about material that has not been cataloged at all? And we talked about the German language. Until the Civil War, Moravians were predominantly German speakers, and they kept their records in German. So that also limits accessibility to the history that is recorded. You do not only need to know the German language, you also have to be able to read the German script. But what if Moravians had not destroyed some of their records? We would have had a much fuller understanding of the Moravian experience of the 18th century. And by that, we would have a better understanding of religion in the early modern era, as Moravian records offer us insight into religious life of the early modern era, at a time when many other groups did not keep good records at all. By close reading of the remaining sources, I was still able to figure out what the sifting time was about or what the difference between Zinzendorf and Lutheran pastor Rothe was about. And this is, of course, the fun part of historical research, to uncover what is not immediately visible at first sight.
So, Paul, your book Herrnhut, The Formation of a Moravian Community, 1722-1732, is newly published. Are you researching and writing about any other aspects of the Moravian Church and its history?
After I finished my book on Herrnhut in English, I translated it to German. That was not quite the same thing as writing a new book, but still it was a big project. So it took some time and did not want to get involved immediately with the next book project. But I just finished a new edition of a dictionary of Moravian terminology that will be published in Germany later this year. I am currently thinking about a new topic, the Moravian Church in America during the antebellum. This will be a book on how the Moravians changed from a German church with church-controlled settlements into an American denomination. It is a time when Moravians changed their views on many things, race, politics, their relationship with the church leadership in Germany, and about the exclusivity of life in Moravian communities.
Does the Moravian Church Archive have any exhibits, exhibitions, or public programs that we should know about?
Yes, you're welcome to stop by. We have a small exhibition in our facility. We have programs, we have lectures, we have workshops and courses. A lot of them are online, and when you go to our website, you can find information about that.
And if we have more questions about Moravian history, where is the best place to reach you?
People can contact me at the Moravian Archives in Bethlehem, and a simple Google search will get you the contact information on the Archives website.
Paul Peucker, thank you for introducing us to the Moravians and the establishment of their communities in early America. We learned a lot. Thank you.
Thank you.
Founded in the 1720s, the Moravian Church quickly spread throughout Europe and North America. Expelled from Moravia, a region within the present-day Czech Republic, Moravians settled all over Europe, with many converging on the German town of Herrnhut at the invitation of Count Nicholas Zinzendorf, who led the church and its people between 1722 and his death in 1760. Now, the Moravians were part of the Philadelphian movement. Members of this movement questioned the ideals and doctrines of established churches, or those churches that were state or government supported. For their part, Moravians desired a return to the Bible's original meanings. They wanted to live as the first Christians lived, which were in communal towns that had a separation of genders. They also looked upon church members as being part of one big family of brothers and sisters. Soon the growth of Herrnhut placed Saxony at odds with the Habsburgs, who were rulers of the Holy Roman Empire. To ease the situation, Zinzendorf sent 40 Moravians to North America between 1735 and 1736. At first, those Moravians settled in Georgia, as the colony's proprietors were actively recruiting settlers. Plus, Georgia appealed to the Moravians because it would put them in close contact with the Creek and Cherokee peoples and with the enslaved, all of whom they hoped to work with and convert. But the Moravians soon left Georgia after communal living created discontent and dissatisfaction. In 1737, part of this group left for Pennsylvania, where they purchased and settled on land along the Lehigh River. They called their new town Bethlehem. Bethlehem worked to become a similar community to Herrnhut. Men, women, and children lived separately. Everyone worked to provide for the community and its people, and the town's governance fell to church governance, where choirs of Moravians met to make decisions and to put important issues to the lot, where Christ could help guide their conclusions. Over time, the Moravians moved away from communal living and altered their theocratic governance. The American Revolution helped inspire some of these changes, as young men and women were tired of putting their choice of marriage partners to the lot and were disappointed when they couldn't bear arms in the war for American independence. As Paul mentioned, what makes the Moravians a fascinating group to study is their international outlook, their communal living, and how they have changed over time. And we can see this change thanks to the very detailed records the Moravians have kept. Now, Moravians were not the only religious group to change and alter their beliefs and governance, which makes their experiences and records wonderful windows through which to view the world of early America and the world of early American religion. It's through the Moravians that we can see pressures placed on religious groups to change and where some of that pressure to change came from. You'll find more information about Paul, his work, and the Moravian Archives, plus notes, links, and a transcript for everything we talked about today on the show notes page. BenFranklinsWorld.com/356. Friends tell friends about their favorite podcasts, so please tell your friends and family about Ben Franklin's World. Production assistance for this podcast came from my colleagues at Colonial Williamsburg Innovation Studios, Joseph Edelman, Holly White, Ian Tonet, and Taylor Fisher. Breakmaster Cylinder composed our custom theme music. This podcast is part of the Airwave Media Podcast Network. To discover and listen to their other podcasts, visit airwavemedia.com. Finally, what other early American religions and religious groups would you like to explore? Let me know. Liz@BenFranklinsWorld.com. Ben Franklin's World is a production of Colonial Williamsburg Innovation Studios.